So welcome to the class, which is scheduled to be the last class for this semester, and the topic which we hopefully will cover relates to anti-dumping duties. Anti-dumping, countervailing. Generally, when I speak, I usually try to abbreviate them as anti-dumping, just because it's easier in my head. However, mostly when I refer to anti-dumping, I generally refer to anti-dumping and countervailing duties. As we discuss this through, we'll figure out what is the difference and how it should be treated. So, having said that, let's dive in. So, anti-dumping. It has been some time since I spoken about anti-dumping duties, and since the last time I spoken, a lot of things have improved as far as information wise, and I think they improved for the better. One thing that customs have done is that since last time I spoken about anti-dumping, which was about 3 years ago or something, customs have improved their informational output to the public. So they created this dedicated web page. Yes, I know sometimes URLs are changing, but nevertheless, be mindful that this page does exist, and they have all new developments that are taking place. On top of that, customs, in addition to anti-dumping duties, we have a new kid on the block, a new regulatory kid on the block, which is called Enforce and Protect Act. This is a brand new stuff. Not too much has been talked or tested about this child, but it is a creature of the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act of 2015, which was signed by President Obama, and it made many changes in the area of customs law. They made changes in the way informal entry. They increased the price from 200 to 800. For Section 321 of the Tariff Act. They introduced a lot of changes to the duty drawback provisions, especially dealing with procedural and documentational requirement, fees, etc. And anti-dumping also has not been to, there was child labor law reporting requirements. There is many stuff that took place in the Trade Facilitation, Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act, and one of this was Enforce and Protect Act. So please be mindful that in light of this new creature, this Enforce and Protect Act, we have a whole new regulation emerging. Let me see. The Section 165. Investigation of claims of evasion of anti-dumping and countervailing duties. We are not going to talk much about it because simply it's so new. What I'd like to say about this is that under the Enforce and Protect Act, you have the new you have a congressional provision which requires that customs conduct investigations from the public about evasion of customs of anti-dumping duties, countervailing duties, mostly anti-dumping. And because customs is required to do that, they make investigation and they do the regulatory inquiry, and if they find out that it is likely to be the subject entity is likely to be evading, then they can impose sanctions in form of anti-dumping duties. So back in 1979, instead of the word subsidy, so CVD, countervailing duties, it's a subsidy by the government, so it's a donation. A subsidy can be like lower electricity cost to make that, for example, to make the box that I just discussed. It can be in the form of grant, right? And what it used to be called, in fact, the subsidy. The term subsidy is somewhat recent. Before it used to be called, as you can see from the 1979 legal text, it used to be called bounty or grant. Bounty or grant, right? Bounties and grants. So, why is it a big deal, or why maybe it's not such a big deal? We can see as we journey through the outline and see the first question. So the customs examiners have tested on this before, and they tested on this quite recently. So the term was no longer in use by the time we hit 1980s. Bounties and grant was taken out, and term subsidy came into the being as far as Congress is concerned, but not as far as customs is concerned, because it took them some time to change this, and they were still testing it for quite a while, even as recently as this question, which I believe came around 2010, something like that, 2011. So the point here is, when you see this type of buzzwords receives a bounty or grant, it refers to countervailing duties, not anti-dumping duties. Usually we see the word normal value when you see anti-dumping. Marking duties, no. Quota, no. Foreign export duties, no. It's countervailing duties. You know the International Trade Commission, this agency should be familiar to you, because in addition to overseeing the injury, material injury, International Trade Commission also is responsible for safekeeping the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. And because classification is a large portion of the questions on a licensed customs broker exam, when you make a reference to the harmonized tariff schedule, you probably see the International Trade Commission one way or another throughout your classification journey. All right, so again, material injury is, you see the quotation mark, whenever you see that, this means that this is something which is determined on a case-by-case basis. This is there is a proceeding, administrative proceeding. If it's contested, then there is a hearing. There is even judicial hearing. So you have this pile and piles of paperwork, including motions, including the memoranda, etc., etc. But basically. It must be material injury is a harm which is not inconsequential, immaterial, unimportant, okay? And factors that agency must consider in saying that the material injury did in fact take place is the volume of imports subject merchandise. So if there is a flood of imports, let's say from China, right, that it wipes out the domestic industry, right, then it goes into the materiality portion. Another factor that the agency must consider is the effects on imports of that merchandise on prices in the United States. So it's not only the flood of imports, but also it's how much do they cost, right? If the imports were flooded, but they were at the similar prices, that would be looked upon as somewhat, or maybe looked upon as somewhat differently, as at much, much lower prices. And this is for Department of Commerce normal value. When Department of Commerce normal value comes into play, and usually Department of Commerce makes the determination first, and then ITC goes in and talks about the, and does its part. So the pricing structure is also a material, because you, if you bring something in at far cost, far lesser cost, and you're like, how do they do that? If you're the manufacturer in the United States, you're looking at the cost of furniture from China, right? And you're like, I have to pay my laborers, I have fixed costs, I have factory costs, I have electricity costs, I have to pay unemployment insurance, I have to pay a bunch of taxes. And even if I do all the savings, the manufacturer may say my fixed costs exceed the retail price of the furniture which they bring in. It's impossible. I can't stay in business, right? So the effect of on prices, right, is, and the prices, let's say from China, right, they also include the transportation cost. They can still do it way cheaper than at way lesser price than the United States manufacturers. They can't compete. They come to US ITC and say, hey, we are injured based on prices as well. And the third point, which I'd like to bring to your attention, is the impact of imports of such merchandise on domestic producers of like products, right? In the context of production within the United States, it must be within the United States. I know we live in a global economy, but we're looking at the nation state. And this is what I just said, is the manufacturer says, because of prices and because of flood of imports, I cannot compete. Final point with respect to the anti-dumping is, why was the Byrne Amendment, repealed? Well, as you know, the Byrne Amendment was found to be illegal. Those are the countries: Australia, Brazil, Chile, EU, India, Indonesia, Japan, Korea. So a bunch of countries, including Canada and Mexico, took United States to the World Trade Organization forum and said, hey, United States, this distribution is illegal. It does not conform to the articles of the WTO Charter, World Trade Organization Charter. There was a bunch of litigation back and forth. It went over to the appellate body, and appellate body confirmed specifically on the Article 32 grounds. And Article 32 grounds pretty much says that if you're gonna take actions, right, against with respect to the countervailing and anti-dumping duties, you must have to do it within the framework of the agreement. And what does the framework of the agreement say? Well, the framework of the agreement, and the appellate division ruling, says that the continued dumping subsidies of said act, aka Byrne Amendment, are not definitive anti-dumping duties, provisional measures, or price undertakings. So, in other words, the World Trade Organization Charter only allowed, if there was a dumping or subsidization taking place, you could only impose the following: anti-dumping duties, provisional measures, or price undertaking. So anti-dumping duties we just discussed. You take the normal value, you establish the margin, you establish the injury, and you establish anti-dumping duties. So that's no-brainer. Provisional measures, so you put, let's say, safeguard quotas, right, for particular period of time, just to figure out what's going on. Price undertaking, this would be some kind of requirement where you force the exporter to raise the price, to undertake the raising of the export price, something which is done at the political level through probably negotiations with the exporting country's government, imposition of licenses, etc., etc. But so this is it. This is what you are limited to within the WTO charter. And so the panel, the appellate division panel, has ruled that passing on whatever collections from anti-dumping duties to the private entities is not within the charter, right? These offset payments are not within the charter, so they are illegal. So that had an effect of U.S. Congress repealing the law, but it still comes as a shadow for us. If you would like to read this fine piece of literature, here it is, World Trade Organization, 2003 document, report of the appellate body, introduction, factual background. So just put this into the Google and you should have it up. So that's it for anti-dumping duties. This is it for the semester. So continue on with your studies. As you continue your preparation, bring on questions. Questions are welcome. And good luck on the exam. And thank you for going through this journey with me.